welcome to Bloomberg Quint. You're watching Insolvency Diaries. The bankruptcy regulator has shut the final door which the promoters could have potentially used to take back control of their insolvent companies. Promoters won't be able to participate in any schemes of arrangement or compromise during the liquidation process as per the rules notified by the regulator today. Further, secured creditors have also been barred from transferring assets to any entity who is ineligible to submit a resolution plan. To understand the implications of these changes, I'm joined by R.K. Bansal, MD and CEO of Edelweiss ARC, and Suharsh Sinha, partner at AZB. Gentlemen, welcome to Insolvency Diaries. Once an insolvent company reaches the liquidation stage, Section 230 of the Companies Act also applies parallelly. This section allows the liquidator appointed under the IBC to consider a scheme of compromise or arrangement proposed by any creditor, shareholder, or the company itself. Now, in a number of cases, the NCLAT has already held that such a compromise cannot be proposed by any entity ineligible to submit a resolution plan. But the IBBI still went ahead and put this question to stakeholders via a discussion paper in November last year. And now what's come in the amended rules is consistent with what the NCLAT has been saying all along. Suharsh, are you seeing this amendment as a clarification, or was there a genuine lacuna in law when it comes to promoter participation via schemes at the liquidation stage that these rules now address?
So if you look at the language of Section 230, it says that even a liquidator can propose a scheme of arrangement. So therefore, if a scheme is proposed by the ex-promoters and the liquidator then supports it and puts it before the COC, then technically under Companies Act, it was not prohibited. If you read that with Section 35, I believe, of the IBC, which says that a sale of assets and liquidation cannot take place to the promoters of the company, there was an interpretation that a scheme of arrangement is not a sale of assets, and therefore promoters are now debarred from proposing or acquiring assets under a scheme of arrangement under IBC. That there was a very, a tenable legal argument could have been made in that respect. But that was completely against the spirit of IBC, because the spirit of IBC was that in a resolution scenario, the 29A debarred promoter should not be allowed to re-enter. And if you allow them to come back via a scheme in the liquidation scenario, then that was obviously a huge moral hazard and would lead to perverse incentives. The NCLT in Gujarat, NRE Coke, I think had held that it is permissible, promoters are not debarred. But then subsequently, NCLAT clearly said that even under a scheme of arrangement, the promoters are debarred. So I think the judiciary was categorical, the NCLAT was categorical, but there was still some scope for doubt if you read the bare text of the law. And I'm glad that the IBBI has not clarified it, that even for a scheme, the 29A debarred persons are not allowed to come back into the company or acquire assets from the company.
Okay. Mr. Bansal, the dilemma that Suharsh spoke of was obviously that, via 29A, promoters have been barred from submitting resolution plans. So why are you allowing them at the liquidation stage? The counter argument to which so far has been that you have taken the company through the resolution process, and since there is no buyer or bidder in the market, rather than liquidating the asset, why not give it in the hands of the promoter, probably the only entity out there in the market who's still willing to take back the asset. Where are you on this side, on this debate? And also, what do you see as the implications now of these amended rules, which have now, given a blanket answer or a no to promoter participation, even via the scheme route?
You see, my feeling is, I think we are mixing up the issue. If you are saying that, let us say, we should allow the promoter to participate in liquidation because there was no resolution plan and no other person came forward, right? In that case, we should allow him to participate in the resolution process itself. I mean, in that case, we should relax the Section 29A itself. So that's a different topic of debate, so I'm not going there. As of now, I feel, because we are not allowing him to give a resolution plan, naturally we don't expect him to participate in liquidation, because otherwise the tendency would be to ensure that company goes into liquidation and then the promoter tries to buy at a much lower price. Now that is why if you see the restriction in today's rule is also there, even the lender, when he wants to sell, secured lender, the asset outside, even then he is not eligible to sell to this guy. Otherwise, the main, maybe the one lender wants to sell the asset outside, taking the help of SARFAESI, not relinquishing in charge. Then also there is a restriction now. This is a new concept. So technically, under SARFAESI, a promoter can always buy the asset back, but that is with the full dues payment. So here we are not discussing the full dues payment. But I agree with you in some way that if you are not getting a resolution plan, if you are not getting some buyer in liquidation, maybe at some stage we should allow the existing borrower promoter because they know the account better. But I would only say that then we should allow him to give a resolution plan itself. Why to go for liquidation?
Sure. So just to be clear, sir, that's not my case at all, that promoters should be allowed. I was just only presenting the other side of the argument that the IBBI also discussed in its discussion paper. I do want to get your views on the new provision that you also spoke about, which is that even creditors will not be able to sell their assets, which are subject to security interest, to any person who is ineligible to submit a resolution plan. Does it, curtail or restrict the ability of secured creditors to find buyers in the market? And how commercially and realistically, how will it work out for creditors like yourselves?
To some extent, it goes against the, SARFAESI Act provisions in that sense that once a company asset we are selling, let us say, and if you put a sale under SARFAESI, existing promoters or buyers can also bid for that asset. But that is going through a transparent system, auction system. So if you are not getting any other offer and this promoter gives a better offer better than others, or there is no other offer, then lenders are free to sell it to him also. So this provision goes against because this provision mainly because it is coming through IBBI. So as under IBC, when we are, stopping this fellow to give a resolution plan, then I think the idea is that in liquidation also he is not allowed. So then even when we are trying to sell one asset, we should not allow, which is slightly harsh, I feel, because sometimes what happens, let's say in liquidation, a company, full company promoter is not interested. But if some particular asset is interested, is ready to give a better value, maybe we should have allowed that.
But how do you bring it, how will the rules determine for which asset should the promoter be allowed or not? Or to your mind, should this have been left to the commercial wisdom, in which case, there can be a suspicion as to whether the secured creditor has acted in good faith or not, and who will then sit in judgment of all of those actions?
So as long as we are, doubting the secured lender himself or his intentions, then there is no, you can't believe anyone then. After all, it is his loan. He has to protect his loan. So he will try to realize maximum. That goes without saying. So if you start, technically this regulation also is going into that direction only, that we are doubting that those guys may sell it back to the promoter. That is why this restriction.
Sure. So, Harsh, what are your views on this restriction that has now come for secured creditors?
Sure. So, on these, the amended regulations, there's one part of it which I wholeheartedly endorse, which is the first aspect which we discussed. The promoter should not be allowed to come back via a scheme of arrangement. But this aspect of the regulations, I have certain reservations. Because the SARFAESI Act in any case sets out a very detailed procedure for secured lenders to enforce their security. Now they can do it by way of a private treaty, they can do it by holding a public auction, by getting quotations from various bidders. So there's already a very detailed process to set out in the SARFAESI Act. After you've run that process, you need to give a 30 days notice to the borrower in case he's able to match the price and he can take back the asset. So there's already a process, a due process of law which is set out. Now, for a secured creditor to run a 29A check each and every time before he's supposed to sell an asset, I think that's very onerous on a secured creditor. Because if you look at the facts and figures, an average time to realize for a company to go into liquidation is more than a year now. It's no longer 270 days or 330 days. So you're looking at a secured creditor having to wait for a year, probably year and a half, before the secured creditor can realize his security. When you are at the stage of realization of security, you are further tying the hands of the secured creditor, saying that you must first conduct a 29A check. Now that itself becomes a huge hurdle. We have seen how 29A is a problematic area even during the resolution process, with an RP in place. Now, there is no RP in place, and you're asking a secured creditor to run that process. Who will check the validity of it? Who will check the sanctity of it? That itself, I think, will become subject to various litigation. And I think at some stage, one needs to respect the fact that a secured creditor has the sole objective of a secured creditor is getting value maximization for the asset which he's trying to recover. The official figures of IBBI, I think, say that the realization in liquidation of a secured creditor is less than 10%. This is either the IBBI or the RBI figures, I'm sure. I'm not quite sure where. But government figures that it's less than 10%. So you're waiting for a year and a half to get 10%. And even realizing that 10%, you have to go through a 29A process. At the end of it, if the promoter makes the best bid for a piece of asset which is being enforced through SARFAC outside the liquidation pool, I personally don't think 29A should be applicable. Because as I said, there's a due process, they're following it, and it's in their personal interest to get the best possible realization. And this extra layer of 29A just adds procedural issues and opens up the gateway for litigation.
Sure. So, let's just clarify this for me, that so far, before these amendments came in, before this, if the secured creditor has decided to not relinquish his interest in towards a liquidation estate, he would have gone under the SARFAESI to enforce that security and probably sell the asset?
That's right.
Okay, all right. You brought a great
That's
point,
right. And
Suhas.
Even under SARFAESI, personally.
Yes, please continue.
Sorry, I was just saying that even under SARFAESI, if you look at the SARFAESI Act, under Section 13.2, once the account has become an NPA, you're supposed to give a 60-day demand notice. After the 60-day demand notice, you're supposed to wait for the borrower to come back with objections. You need to consider the objections. After that, you need to run the bid process. After you run the bid process, you need to give 30 days to the borrower to come back and try and match it. So in any case, you're looking at another 120 to 150 days elongation of the process. And if you add another layer of 29A, I just think realization for secured creditors will get seriously compromised.
Okay, Mr. Bansal, would you agree with this view? And also, how painful would this be for creditors to now do this Section 29A assessment? Because it could be that people who have, you know, come during the resolution process are not the same buyers at the liquidation stage. How realistic will it be for creditors to do this within a certain timeline, which I'll come to in just a bit?
I think I don't find that is a big worry, that who is buying. So as long as they will give a certificate and they can satisfy themselves about 29A, that should not be the problem. The problem, again, as Suhas is saying, I think the issue is, if you have no buyer other than them, then what do you do? And why are you trying to override SARFAESI Act under these regulations? Not through the Act, by the way. This is only through regulation, which I feel slightly difficult. So I think that need to relax 29A itself will be felt more and more, I think, in future. My feeling is that.
Suhas, the regulator has also brought in a timeline within which the secured creditors would have to either sell the asset or submit it to the liquidation estate. And they've done so in a slightly indirect manner. They have said that once a secured creditor has decided not to relinquish its interest at the liquidation stage, he has to, within 90 days, pay to the liquidator its share towards workmen dues, and within 180 days, pay the excess of the realized value of the asset over the amount of his admitted claims. What do you see as the implication of this, and can you sort of explain how this will work?
Sure. So I'll go back to the example I was citing earlier. Not the example really, but the process under SARFAESI. So let's assume you're a SARFAESI creditor, you're trying to enforce under that. There's no way you're possibly going to recover your dues by selling an asset under SARFAESI in 90 days. I don't think it's practically feasible. There's 60 days of notice, then you know you need to give the borrower some time to make representations, then you do an auction, then you give 30 days to the borrower. So you're already looking at 120, 150 days. So I think the 90-day deadline in any case is bound to be missed. What do the regulations say? That in case you're not able to hand over your part of the CIRP cost within 90 days, then it'll be as per the estimation of the liquidator. Now, in case the liquidator makes an estimation which is over generous for the company, then obviously that leads to certain value loss for the secured creditor. The regulations don't go on to say what will be the means of challenging that estimation that the liquidator has made, what is the basis for the liquidator's estimation itself. The regulations are silent on it. But what is, I think, slightly more worrying is that in case the secured creditor does not hand over that amount within 90 days, then the asset itself shall be deemed to be submitted to the liquidation estate.
The timeline for that is 180 days.
Secured creditor. So it says so the 180 is in case you have any excess realization over and above your admitted claim.
So give me an example here, Suharsh. Practically speaking, let's say my admitted claim is 100 rupees and I have realized 200 from it. This excess 100 is what I need to pay to the liquidator within 180 days, which will mean that I need to make a decision or sell the asset within those 180 days, right? Is my understanding correct?
That is right. That's right. Absolutely right. So, but the problem is that I may not be able to do that in 180 days, because even for immovable property, SARFAC itself provides that you can take 25% cash upfront and the remaining can be deferred as per mutual agreement. Now, if my agreed amount is 200 and I get 25% upfront, I get 50 upfront, but the remaining 150 will take me probably 6 months or 9 months to realize. And it may not even get realized in case the buyer is unable to pay up. So why should I be, as a secured creditor, be out of pocket before having even received the funds which I'm due to receive from the buyer? So that I think is an area of concern, because now we are going into the realm of estimation of my recovery as a secured creditor by a liquidator who has no fiduciary responsibilities towards me anymore as a secured creditor. And in case I'm not able to follow the guidelines and the timelines set out by the liquidator, then I risk that the asset itself may be taken over by the liquidator. The constitutionality of it, let's not get into. But I think by way of regulation, we are trying to introduce something which can be quite onerous.
Mr. Bansal, how would you see this play out in real life out there? Would it ensure faster decision making by secured creditors? And in the process of making that faster decision within the timelines that Suharsh just spelled out, do you see that the asset will not be realized to its maximum value because the secured creditors then lose any right over it within after 180 days?
I think the rules are becoming more and more stringent, and I think it is putting too much focus on secured lenders as if they are not taking decisions. So I agree with the Swiss. I think the problem is in 90 days or in 180 days, you don't expect. I have seen cases now in liquidation more than 1 year, nothing is happening by the liquidator. On liquidator, you have no control. And you expect only secure lenders to try to sell this asset within 9 months, 3 months or 9 months. And if you don't do, you share the expenditure, you give it the asset back. I mean, you are forcing basically the system. Maybe the purpose seems to be that liquidator will be able to do better job than the secure lenders themselves. I don't know where are we heading, but at least to me, it looks onerous on the part of secured lenders only, that they are only expected to do things in time, and people feel that they are only not taking decision, which I feel is, what about NCLT? What about NCLAT? Cases are not getting admitted in 1 year. That IBBA is not doing anything, I think. Anyway, let us not go into that. That's a different area. But I still feel this is not a right provision. You are trying to introduce something through regulations, which is, I think, not there in the Act.
Okay, so Suharsh, how would you have liked this to be addressed? Because in its discussion paper in November, the IBBI spelled out a figure close to 20,000 crores. The assets are worth 20,000 crores sitting with secured creditors and no decision making is happening on it. So how would you have liked to see the rules change to address the problem of, ensuring faster decision making by secured creditors, and then on the other hand, not putting them in a position where they're losing money?
So, I think the realization by secured creditors is a problem which is something which may be beyond IBBI's remit. I mean, this is more of an issue for probably the RBI or for the banking sector. If you're looking at IBC as a legislation and the role of the IBBI is to make sure that the IBC process runs in a time-bound manner and without any hiccups. Now, the sole objective of IBBI, I personally believe, in the liquidation scenario, is to make sure that everybody pays out what is their due in the liquidation process. So as a secured creditor, if I'm not participating in the, if I'm not relinquishing and I'm trying to enforce it myself outside of the process, how long I take, what manner of realization I do, and who I sell to is my business. I personally don't think IBBI should get into it, except to the limited extent that I also need to pay back to the liquidation estate certain proportion of the costs. And those costs are my proportionate share of the CIRP costs and my proportionate share of the cost to liquid to 24 months of workmen and employees. That's the limited part I think the IBC and the IBC infrastructure should really be bothered about. And as far as that is concerned, I think without going into how much I actually realize as a secured creditor, if the prescription was that this is the estimated liquidation value and this is the estimated realization value for you as a secured creditor, and X percent of that should be handed over. And that should not be linked to, or rather to incentivize me to realize my security as quickly as possible, or to sell my security to a certain bidder or not to a certain bidder. So I think the remit of the regulations needs to be limited to ensuring that I pay up my cost and should not in any way go into trying to incentivize me to make realizations. Because that is something which I think is, from a regulatory perspective, is the RBI's domain and is for, you know, for the banks themselves to take into account.
Okay, Mr. Bansal, you know, Suhash hinted at that, but do you see there is a potential legal challenge that can be mounted or secured creditors would like to bring in, given that their hands have been significantly tied in terms of who they decide to sell at the liquidation stage?
There can be, but typically secured lenders, actually most of these cases, most of the secured lenders are public sector banks. And they typically don't challenge regulations and act somehow. There's a feeling that why should we, I mean, they don't want to be seen like that. So maybe they will try talking to them or try to make a change, make a representation. That could be a way out also, instead of giving only legal challenge. But maybe some private sector bank or a foreign bank or I think fund or anyone else, NBFC, could challenge it.
All right, Mr. Bansal, I'll let that be the last word on the show. Thank you and Suhash for joining us here on Insolvency Diaries and sharing with us the implications as to the amended rules on liquidation under Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code. Thank you for watching and joining us here on Bloomberg Quint.